Aloha, everybody. This is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to another edition of Watch Me Work. We're going to pick up with our High Elf Chariot. We're going to continue painting the lions here. And as you can see, this particular lion, his mane is just about finished. I do think that after our Devlin mud wash that we did the last time, I think it's a little bit too dark. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back in with that last highlight that I had and just kind of fix it a little bit. So that's what I'm going to do right now. Alrighty. I apologize for the delay in getting back to this. It's been a very, very hectic couple of weeks. But that's alright. Now, oh yeah, that's much better. Okay, just a little to bring it out. Just to kind of get those little textured bits lighter. I think that'll probably do. It helps to pop out that color just a touch. Just a little bit. And I did notice a spot on the tail that seemed to be lacking color. My guess would be he's been laying on that part of his tail. But that's okay. I technically need to do the entire tail anyway because it's also had that wash of Devlin mud on it. I think we washed it in Devlin mud. Pretty sure we did. Let me look at my recipe real quick. Yep, Devlin mud. Alright. So, I think we're going to call the mane and the tail on this lion done. Assuming I don't drop it and knock more paint off of it. So, let us move to the other one. Alright. And let's see here. We're going to need to mix up some more paint. By the way, if this is the first episode of Watch Me Work that you have joined us for, first of all, welcome. Second of all, you may be wondering why I'm not giving real instruction in this, and that is simply because this is not meant to be an instructional video. These are simply, as the title suggests, things where you can just kind of sit back and watch me create a little small piece of art. Nothing big or fancy about it or anything, it's just real simplistic. And I just screwed that up. So what I need to do is add one more drop of brown. There we go. Alright. So let's get our brush out here. I'm going to set that line aside. Pull this guy up to the forefront, blow off any dust that might have accumulated on him, and we'll get started. But let's take a look at the difference in the two of them first of all. Huge, huge difference you can see there in the coloration of the not just the manes, but the obviously the lion's face itself. But you can kind of get an idea where we're going by taking a look at this one. Let me see if I can cover up his paw and the unpainted stuff. There we go. Now he looks like the head of a lion, which is good. Because it'd be really weird if it looked like the head of, say, a giraffe or something. Alright, so I'm just going to mix some color up here. And that is so not going to work. Well, it might. It might. I think it's still too dark. But we'll find out. No, that's about the same color as the last one. So, I'm going to load my brush up. Start painting. Alrighty. I'll just start with the tail here, since that's fairly simplistic. Get my plate out of the way, because it reflects light. It's going to mess up the camera shot. So we'll do this. Alright. Just a nice, easy dry brush. There we go. Try and do the entire mane, sans the re-highlight after the wash, because obviously the wash is going to take some time to dry. And now that I know where I'm going as far as creating the colors and everything for my highlights, shouldn't take nearly as long. Then we can move on to bigger and better things like the body of the lion. All right. You may not notice a huge change between this color and the last, and that's perfectly fine. This is really, it's sort of a highlight, but I also like to use these first dry brush colors, if I'm doing something in a dry brush, to color over areas that, for one reason or another, have lost their color. Either they've been knocked against something and the paint has chipped, or whatever the case may be. It's always good to just have that base color back in place. Okay. By the way, for those of you interested, I've mentioned Bob Ross many times during this during these videos, and we do mention him a lot in our DVDs and things like that. If you're interested in seeing some of the stuff that he's got, Bob's company, well, the people that own his company that he's passed on, they're very, very notorious for taking down any videos off of the internet, off of YouTube, or anywhere else for that matter. And so it's somewhat difficult to find the videos of him painting, but I did find out, and I've actually picked up a few of them through my local library, that every episode that he's ever done as far as painting a picture of any kind is available on DVD. And so if you have the ability, I would definitely recommend picking up a couple of those. I wouldn't necessarily recommend buying them. They're about $30 a piece, and I think there's 60 of them in total. So huge, huge investment if you're going to go that route. But it's definitely a show that you should check out, because if you want to see a painter that is not only a wonderful painter, and a heck of a human being, I mean, really just a stand-up guy, but someone who is an absolute master of being able to explain what they're doing and why they're doing it, so that you too can repeat that process and come up with the same or at least a very, very similar result, I would definitely recommend checking out Bob's DVDs, because they are fantastic. I've seen probably the first, I think 3 or 4 seasons of his show on DVD. That's what my local library carries. I'm not going to spend that kind of money to purchase them, but definitely worth taking a look at. It's amazing to watch someone create quite literally a masterpiece of art in a 30-minute time frame, and at the same time give you instruction on how to do it so that you can copy exactly what he did. Now, obviously, it's probably going to take you a little bit more than 30 minutes, but it's still really a fascinating thing to see happen. So, highly recommend them, definitely. Alright, now, if my memory serves me correctly, this is my second highlight color. Let me check my map. Yes, it is. Good, okay. By the way, I learned this lesson kind of the hard way. When I first got started in painting miniatures, I was really working with just a few different models in the Tyranid range, and I was fine with just laying them down for 2-3 months, moving on to another model, and then coming back and picking them up again. That was fine, because pretty much they were all the same color. Well, for different species of the Tyranids, like all the Gene Stealers I had were one color, or one specific set of colors. All the Termagants I had were one specific set of colors. But as I branched out and I began to paint things outside of the Games Workshop realm, specifically moving into the Reaper realm, that was the first set of models I had outside of GW stuff, I began to learn that I can't just let a model sit for like 6 or 7 months, because that model may have a paint scheme that I can't remember. And so it's a very good idea, if you're painting any miniature, I don't care what kind of model it is, unless it's something you're going to be doing thousands of or hundreds of, write down what you used to paint the miniature with, just in case you happen to have to go back and redo it. it makes things a lot easier. Now, I got to tell you, I'm really good at color matching. That's one of the things that I am... I don't claim to be a master of it, but I am exceptionally good at matching colors. I've had people come up to me before at conventions, and one of the things I do when I go to conventions is I paint while I'm sitting there with the camera just like it is now, where you guys can see it, but I have it panned into a television, again, like it is now, but instead of me looking at it to make sure I'm in frame, I have that TV, or those TVs, as I've done in recent conventions, facing outwards so that the people walking by can see what I'm doing. And they have a view just like this. But I've had several people come up to me at conventions while I've been there and say, you know, hey, you're a very good painter. Can you fix my model? And what has happened is over time that model has chipped or cracked or whatever the case may be. And so I go back in and I repaint the model doing what I call color matching, which is basically figuring out what colors have disappeared and being able to recreate the miniature as it originally was. And that is one of the most valuable skills you can have, is being able to go back and look at a miniature, even if it's one that you've never touched before, and say, okay, I can recreate that particular color on that particular model by blending X colors together. And it may take you 2 or 3 minutes to come up with a color combination that is a very close proximity to what is being used on the miniature. But once you can do that, you can basically copy anybody's work, and that makes you an unbelievable asset to anybody that wants a commission work done and they want, say, a piece of art from a like a codex or something like that copied. You can look at something like that and within just a matter of minutes come up with the colors utilized to create that object or to create the that particular effect. And it's a very, very valuable skill to have. Highly recommend learning how to color match. That is probably one of the top skills, I would say, you need to become a great miniature painter. All right, I think we're going to call that good as far as our next highlight. I think my phone is buzzing. It is. It's only two buzzes, so it's a text message. It can wait, because you guys are more important. All right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up some of this next highlight, and I hope I've still got some left over, but, you know, it doesn't look like I've got that much, so I'm going to go ahead and mix up a little bit more and see how it goes. All right, there's one, two, there's that, and let's do this. Wow, okay. So, quick lesson, I said I wasn't going to teach you anything during these things, but occasionally a lesson comes up. Vallejo has the nasty tendency to leak every now and again. I still love their paint, and to be honest with you, their bottles are far better than the Reaver Master Series bottles. And not to say anything of the paint, which we've already done that. But because of the leakage, the cap can sometimes get really nasty, goopy stuff on the inside of it. And that stuff can dry over time, and what you can end up with is this right here. When you pull the bottle out, all of that dried paint, for some reason, sticks to the eyedropper of the paint bottle that you're using to remedy that, and I would definitely recommend remedying it, because otherwise you're just compounding the problem. Simply take a portion of your paper towel that you're working with. Just grab the affected area of rubbery paint and just pull it off. And now you have a nice, clean eyedropper bottle so that when you put it back into the top right here, it won't have as much of a gap between the bottle itself and the cap here. And so not as much air will get into this paint and dry it out. Now, just a quick aside, figured I'd let you know, because lots of people probably have that problem. All right, now, let's get a little bit more color here on the palette. And again, I apologize if this is a somewhat boring video for you. I know it's not for everyone, but My hope is that these will be somewhat relaxing, things that you can just kind of paint along to, and every now and again maybe look up at the screen, see what I'm doing, and say, hey, that's pretty cool. But, you know, whatever. There we go. I think we're going to call that pretty good. Alright. Now, let's scrub the brush out here. That does not look like the same color. Oh well, we'll give it a shot. See what happens. Why not? Let's see, we're at 15 minutes, so hopefully this shouldn't take more than 2 or 3, and then we can... Oh, that works fairly well. Alright, and to be honest with you, you know, when you're dealing with something like this, they don't have to match completely. I mean, every line on the planet doesn't have the exact same hair color, so, we'll come close. Pick up a little bit more color. Alright, and then we're going to come down here, and we're just going to dust over the lion. Alright. If you're interested in learning how I'm doing any of this stuff, be sure to please check out our line of how to paint DVDs. We've got a generic DVD called Masterpiece Miniatures. Really fantastic 3-DVD set for those of you that are fairly new to the hobby and just want a nice overview of different techniques and skills. And then we've got some model-specific DVDs that will teach you how to go from start to finish on a particular miniature. But the idea behind them is that you can then take those techniques that you've learned in that miniature, or by painting that miniature, and apply them to any model that you'd like to. All right. Really, really invaluable stuff. I highly recommend them. Not just because I've, you know, made them, but because I think they're worthwhile. Really do. Alright. And there we go. Alrighty. That is pretty darn good. I'll call it just about done. I think I'm going to add one more highlight to this one just to make it a touch lighter. I don't know. I mean, it looks pretty good, but I think it needs to a little bit more differentiation between the mane and the, what do we call that? The, I guess you'd call it scalp. A little more differentiation between the hairs of the mane. How about that? That's a good way to phrase it. Oh, that's a lot of color. Whoops. All right, we'll see what it makes. This is pretty acceptable. Twirl my brush, paint off, and then really scrub it out. Alright, so we shall come back to the model now. That little tip of his tail really does not like keeping paint on it. I'm going to have to remember that and not lay it on that particular section. And I'm really just, at this point, I'm just kind of fast brushing over the model. I don't really care where the paint goes. I just want a little bit of extra color in there somewhere. Okay, oh yeah, there we go. Just like that. I think that's acceptable. So, now, let's grab our wash. First of all, scrub my brush out. Not that it really matters. This is my junk brush. Okay, and let's grab a wash. Devlin mud. Now, I'm not sure how the new washes are, I'll be honest with you, but in these old washes, the pigment tended to settle on the bottom. The problem is, if you shake them, you end up with nothing but a big thing of bubbles all over the place. So I found it really easy just to swirl the liquid, and it picks the pigment up off the bottom of the bar, or off the bottom of the jar, and you don't get the bubble effect. Just FYI for those that are having difficulties with the current line of GW washes. Again, I don't know what those washes are, and I don't know how they how they're composed. I'm sure they're made in the same manner that GW has always made their washes, but who knows? Maybe not. Maybe it's something completely different that doesn't settle like these do, but I doubt it. All right, just going to pick up a little bit of this on the brush. A little bit, nothing. I'm going to need a heap of it. All right. All right, we'll start with that much and just see what happens. Touch the tail here. Now this one I'm looking at, I'm thinking I might not have to come back and re-highlight this one. Interesting. Maybe that extra highlight eliminated that need. We shall find out. Alright, let's just put this in there like that. I have to pick up some more color. And we'll just do this. Wow, this takes a lot of wash. I don't recall it taking quite this much last time. I'm going to run out of wash. Hopefully I won't run out before them. I'm done with this mane, though. I've got about half a bottle, so should be okay. A little air bubble there I'll need to pop. Alright. Well, I think that's about it. I'm going to let this dry, and possibly we will come back next time and put in that extra highlight. I don't know if we will or not. We'll see how it ends up turning out. But for right now, I think we're going to call that a video, and we'll move on and work on the skin or the other fur of these lions in the next video. But until then, I hope that you've enjoyed this episode of Watch Me Work on the High Elf Chariot. And if you have any comments or questions, please put those down in the comments section down below. Thank you very, very much for watching, guys. If you hadn't subscribed to AG Productions, be sure to go ahead and do that. And leave, boom, a little thumbs up if you wouldn't mind. And that's all I've got for you guys today. So again, thank you very much for watching. God bless you all. Have a fantastic rest of the day. And I will see you all in the next video.